so cool, right? That's really great. Thank you, Lexi, for the introduction. You know, and also Lexi gives the best hugs. So like a little known fact about me, I actually don't like to be hugged that much. But Lexi is one of the few people that when she goes in for the hug, I'm like, it's about to be great. So that's really what you get when you get with Lexi. So tonight, it's kind of going to be broken into two parts, right? So first of all, when I was thinking about this subject, I was like, how can I actually put this in a way that makes sense, is very valuable to people? So you'll notice that the name of this is actually The Path to Product Management. And it's because I wanted to give a lot of foundational context as to what I think it takes to get into product management. So we'll go through the presentation part of this. And then at the end, we'll do Q&A. And so in Q&A, you can feel free to ask me anything about product management, whether, you know, illuminating some of the points that I'm going to make here, or even if there's some people in there who are already doing product management where you have questions about actually what you're doing, feel free to also ask that. And then Lexi and Isabel will actually go through and provide those questions to me later. So let's get started. So as a product manager, I never do a presentation that doesn't have an agenda. So what are we going to do? So first, we're going to talk a little bit about who I am and why I have some authority to actually talk about this. Then we're going to actually talk a little bit about the skills and everything like that you have to do to get in product management. Then we're going to get into the nitty gritty, like what the actual pay scale looks like here. And then some of the actual specific programs and things like that you can pursue. And then we're also going to talk a little bit about the pitfalls of being a product manager. So starting off, where have I been? So first of all, before I actually had my first product management job, I pretty much had every job ever, which is why, you know, Lexi's point about me kind of being this person who's navigated numerous industries is very valid. You know, I started off, my very first job out of college was actually as a management consultant, but then I graduated in 2008 and the economic downturn happened. So 3 months after I started, I was laid off and I was actually a barista at Teavana. And I'm gonna be truthful, like that tea at Teavana was the best. It was like crack. I highly suggest Teavana tea. It's delicious. But then I was a store manager at Target before I ever got into the tech path. And so those are the things that I always kind of take in hand, is that, you know, my primary skill set is honestly just being able to navigate really difficult people. And then you add a little technology on that, and that's how I became a product manager. And so my first real like product management experience starts at a company called Wyzant, where their logo really is an ant. Then I was at cars.com in Chicago. I was at a company called Sprout Social that was a startup when I was there, but it recently went public. I was at Apple before Netflix, and now I'm at Netflix. And in addition to that, I also taught at product school in Chicago. And, you know, so I've spent many cycles, you know, actually teaching product skills and what that means. And I'm a product manager mentor, so I mentor a lot of product managers. Now, having said all that, you know, this is a myriad.
I'm so sorry to interrupt you, but we cannot see your screen.
Interesting. Technical issues is pretty much the way that this always goes, right?
Especially in tech.
All right. What do you see now?
Now we can see it.
Awesome.
Now.
There's a separate button I had to press, y'all. I hate Zoom. This is my whole life. Oh, by the way, I do have Zoom stock though, so I only hate it a little bit. So let me go back through there. So these are just the logos that I was showing before. Now, so what are the traits of a PM? So first of all, the very first trait is you have to be curious. So I think that this is probably the most important part of being a product manager. The reason I say that is because being curious is the foundation of going through and figuring out like what the actual problem is, right? So if you don't have that capacity to be curious, you're gonna get led down paths that are not gonna really effectively help you do your role. Then you have to lead with authority. So the thing about being a product manager, which is kind of an interesting position to be in, is that you're a leader within your organization, but most often product managers have no ability to hire or fire people. In fact, all you can ever hope, so for instance, I can think of so many times where I worked with engineers and designers who I actually thought were terrible at their jobs, and I was so shocked that I had to work with them. But at the same time, I had no authority to chastise them or do anything other than try to kind of help them be better at what they did. And the way that you are able to kind of help mold people and help influence people to kind of do the right thing is by having that, like, demanding a certain amount of authority in each room. Then you have to be analytical. So every single product manager job now, this wasn't so much my experience when I first started. So I started off, my first product management job was in 2012. And that's when a lot of people were still focusing on just like the basics of building websites and things like that. And so we weren't really into that, like the fully functional A/B testing and things like that. And so you do have to be super analytical now. And when I say analytical, there's two aspects to this. So there's the analytical of asking the right questions, but then there's also the analytical of actual technical skills. So that's the ability to, use SQL or R or other things to go into databases and get specific information. You have to be a self-starter. So especially for product managers, sometimes the ratio of product managers, in fact, the ratio of product manager to engineers at most of the companies I've worked at have been something like 1 to 20, right? And so what that means is that there are very few other product managers who are available, right? And because there are very few product managers who are actually available, that means that at a very specific level, you know, you're always going to be that leader. You're always going to be that person who's supposed to go in and actually figure out exactly what needs to be done. And in fact, sometimes you're even more responsible for the company in some ways than even the CEO. So like you really have to be able to wake up every day with like a specific plan and then execute on it. And you have to be self-aware. So because you have so much influence and you can be so demanding, you have to be self-aware enough to know, like, to continually interrogate and make sure you're thinking about the right things and making sure that you can kind of proceed and be successful in that role. And so, you know, if you look at that, it actually spells out class. And, you know, if one thing we know about Black folks is that we got a lot of classy Black women. So you have to have class is the way that I always think about product managers, is that they're usually the most important aspect of a successful, you know, company that sells products, right? And so you have to have like all of those different skills. So I love this quote. It says, you know, a great product manager has the brain of an engineer, the heart of a designer, and the speech of a diplomat. And what's really funny about that is that, so I kind of mentioned that my background is kind of a myriad of backgrounds, but also I had no technical training for most of my career. So I was actually a history and political science major in undergrad. I do have a graduate degree in information systems, so a master of information systems. But again, it was kind of through that lens of how to manage technology people versus actually the hands-on skills of engineering. And so one of the things that I also encourage people is that when you think about this quote, and it says it has the brain of an engineer, what you really need to do is figure out, where do engineers go to be inspired? You know, so there's lots of websites out there and there's lots of blogs. So for instance, I think the Netflix technical blog is amazing. So is Google's technical blog. Those companies are also great examples of companies that are building new technology that is going to be very important to technology teams moving forward. So those are all those are the types of ways that I think about from an engineering perspective, because again, I find that more and more people actually don't have any type of technical background. And so you have to figure out how to go about doing that. Same thing with being a designer. There's numerous designers out there. So the Instagram designers, like basically, I would do a search for who works in design and Instagram and follow them everywhere, because they're a really great example of a very sophisticated high-level design team. Another example is also Sprout Social. Another example, Envision has like their list of like key partners that they partner with. You can also follow all those different companies and you can start figuring out design principles and get, you know, become really, really well-educated for that. And also from a product perspective, I always think, you know, designers are the ones who remind me to be empathetic, because I have that analytical mindset. I've also learned those engineering skills. And so when you have all of that particular energy, you forget to kind of take a step back and say, you know, what does it mean to have a lovely experience? So really, you know, honing and working on your design understanding is really great. And then last is this idea of a speech of a diplomat. The one thing I would note here is that it's like speech of a diplomat, but also a salesperson, right? So there's a bunch of really great books about selling and how, you know, you shouldn't be afraid to sell yourself. You shouldn't be afraid to sell your product or sell your talent, because it is just the core to who you are, right? And so there's one by Daniel Pink that's called How Selling is Human, right? And it's one of the foundational books in my own personal life that kind of helped me take this idea of, you know, like when I'm selling someone on something, all I'm actually doing is partnering with them to create a relationship with them so that we could be more successful. So again, you know, when you break down this quote, there's like so much here in terms of these are like those core attributes, and you can actually go out and get those particular skills as necessary. So common background. So I tried to think about, you know, having kind of talked to hundreds and hundreds of product managers at this point in my career, I put together this list of like the common backgrounds that I see pretty consistently. So, you know, there's, you know, obviously engineering, marketing communications, research and development, customer support, consulting, sales support, technical support, design, quality, or operations management. And so for a little bit of context, remember I said some of the jobs I had before I actually got into product management, I was a store manager at Target. So, you know, that's customer support. I was also a tech support manager at a small startup called Sharecell. And so those two roles especially really gave me a lot of the context I needed to then kind of take those skills and then apply them to product management. And so let's pretend, you know, you have these backgrounds and you actually want to get into product management. So there's a few different ways to get into product management. So at larger organizations, so if you think of like the Googles, the Facebooks, the, you know, Microsoft, there are like these associate product management roles or rotational programs. Apple also has like this rotational program where you kind of go through all of these different areas of the business as a product manager and you kind of build those up. However, they're only at the largest programs. And something to kind of note there is that I've seen two common ways that people get into these programs. So either one, they're internal transfers who, you know, have proven themselves to be super amazing at what they do. And as a result, they're able to get into these programs, or they're MBA folks who get into these programs through their MBA program. So that's something to kind of keep in mind. So that's kind of like the super special, only a very small number of people actually come through that particular pathway. Then you can be a subject matter expert. And so this is actually how I really got into product management. So a few of my first roles were all in marketing technology. And so because of that, when I was going out for my very first, like, you know, real product management roles, they were actually at marketing technology companies. And so because I was a subject matter expert at marketing technology, they were very much willing to risk, you know, hiring me on as their product manager. And really effectively, that was my end. So for instance, when I mentor someone, I was mentoring a young woman recently, and her degree is in biology because she thought she's going to be a doctor. And she's decided she doesn't want to be a doctor. And she was just like, you know, B, how do I get into technology? And I was just like, well, you should go look for biotech companies, right? Like, go look at those biotech companies. There's a million out there, and that will give you an opportunity to, you know, get into the field in a way that makes sense for you. So if there's some specialty that you have, that is really that's a really good angle to get into a company and have them, you know, take you seriously from a product management perspective. And so then we have like the certificate graduate program type route. So the main examples of this are like product school and some other organizations like this. Now I'm going to tell you my personal opinion because this is supposed to be a masterclass and I'm supposed to be very truthful to you. So when I was teaching at product school, one of the things that was very frustrating for me is, you know, I'd have a class of 8 to 10 people at a time, and maybe one or two of those people were actual people who had the skills to be product managers. And what I mean by that is, going back to that idea of class, these were people who, who really could lead. They were very analytical. They were very curious, and they just got it, right? Like, there are people that if you were to see them and go, oh, I've met other product managers, you would say they felt like product managers. There were a lot of other people who just thought the career path was very cool. And so they didn't really have it. And so I'm not necessarily a huge fan of a lot of these certificate programs because anyone can technically take them, but not everyone actually has the acumen or like the innate, like emotional intelligence type skills, I think, that you have to be a product manager. So if you do decide to do a certificate or graduate program, one thing you want to check on is the teacher, right? So like there's a big difference along a lot of these programs on who's teaching the course, because the teacher makes a huge difference in terms of one, the content and whether you're going to retain it. But the teacher also is the person who's going to help you network. So for instance, I'm still connected to every single person I ever taught in product school, and I still, you know, provide them help or support and things like that. And so there's a big difference there. Now outside of product school, there's obviously, you know, Northwestern has a program, University of Chicago has a program. There's so many other, like those larger programs. Again, in my experience, right, unless those particular programs have like specific ends to certain companies, most of us who are actually product managers, we don't even refer to those graduate programs. So I say this because this is a path for you, but it's only if you're like super selective and ensure that it's a program that has a very great reputation that will help you navigate the process. So this is another quote. So this is actually from one of my directors at cars.com. And so the things that, so it goes back to this idea of the different like pockets of PMs, right? So it's like, you know, you have the engineer turned PM, you have the designer turned PM, you have the business person turned PM. But what I really wanted to, you know, kind of note here is that, you know, one of the biggest things about product management is that, especially from an interview perspective. So this quote, I think, especially, if you're going to go interview as a product manager, you should like internalize this quote, because this is exactly what, you know, product leaders want to hear, which is, you know, we know our lane. You know, we are specialists in understanding how other people provide value to the process and then kind of taking all of that together and making something great. You know, we're not going to, we should not, product managers should not be responsible for figuring out exactly how you're going to engineer something or exactly how you're going to design something. You know, product management is really about delivering the greatest business value to the business. And the greatest business value is making sure that you retain your time and energy for what makes sense, and then letting other people do the other things that they would do. So, this is the part that I know myself personally was what I was most interested in, and one of the reasons I pushed so hard to get into product management. We're gonna talk about money. Like, money is very important. So the great thing about product management, there's a few different careers. So usually, depending on your organization, you might start off as a business analyst or a product analyst before you would even become an associate product manager. So I wanted to put up here, by the way, all these salaries are from Glassdoor and they're national averages. So this, a lot of people always criticize, they're like, are these Bay Area salaries? No, these are actually the national averages. So this is information you can kind of take to the bank. So the starting salary for business analyst is about $68,000. Associate product managers are $96,000. Product managers are $109,000. Senior product managers and product leads are about $124,000. Directors of product are $149,000. And VPs of products are $181,000. And chief product officers are $194,000. So the one thing I will say here, I know that there was a thread in the Sista Circle recently where people were talking about salaries. And a lot of folks were like, man, like I must be doing the wrong thing because like my salary is much lower. And so if you looked at, if you are interested in product management, most of the salaries on this slide were kind of in those higher brackets that people were saying they were trying to get to. So for that reason, you know, one of the things I always tell people is that the outlook for product management is very sunny. Like there's a lot of good stuff out there. Companies really, really believe that, you know, it's super valuable, and that it's something, it's a profession that, you know, people are very, very interested in. But having said that, I would be remiss if I didn't talk about the not so sunny things that are going on. So let's talk about the pitfalls. So first and foremost, I think the number one thing that is often a major issue for product management is that there's a lot of confusion between project, program, and product managers. And so I want to take a little bit of time to kind of define how you can think about these different roles and how they can operate separately. So first and foremost, the first thing that I always say is like project management, there obviously are professional organizations like the PMP and things like that, where they specifically certify you to be a project manager. However, the one thing about project management is that most project management roles often don't require any other, like don't require an advanced level training or acumen, because you could technically go into a project management manager right now in any type of company. So, you know, it could be an architecture firm, it could be, you know, a technology company, it could be, you know, a design company. So there's lots of different ways that project managers can kind of just work without any type of formal training. Program managers, there's two types of program managers. So there's kind of like the technical program managers and the non-technical program managers. So program managers often have like a specific specialty area, and it usually requires some kind of higher level acumen in the specialty area. You know, so for instance, an engineering program manager, which is something that is often at companies like Apple or Google or Amazon, they work directly on the engineering teams, and they have an intense level of technical expertise that allows them to help engineering programs be successful. Non-technical program managers usually exist within a company, and they can be everywhere from, you know, IND or legal or any of those other types of parts of the business, but they have like a specific core function that they monitor and kind of, they own that part, they own a particular program within the company or within a particular division of a company. Then you have product managers. So product managers are, you know, based on like what I've previously said, there's different ways to get in there, but generally speaking, especially with modern product managers, you're gonna be like a highly focused, business expert who sits in between the design, engineering, and the rest of the business. And so it's a slightly different nuance here. And so one of the pitfalls is that companies often say, for instance, they need a project manager, but it actually is a product manager they need, or they need a product manager, and it's actually a project manager that they have. And in fact, in my own career, I've worked at companies where I was just like, I'm so confused because I thought you hired me as a product manager, but no, this is not really product management. Like, let me explain to you what product management is, and let's figure out how to actually get me there. I'm not going to say which company that is because that company, they're very litigious, and I don't want to get in trouble. But it is an example of like the types of things that kind of go on, and it's something that like even as a product, the product world. Right, it's something that we're continuing to kind of, force and talk about how we need to continue to evolve people's understanding of product management. So then there's a lack of defined career development structure. And so what I mean here is that, so there's lots of different types of product orgs, right? So there's the product orgs that are very mature. And so those are usually large companies. Again, so it's like those, again, it's the Facebooks, the Googles, the Netflixes, the Apple. So they very clearly have like a chief product officer, a VP of product, directors of product, et cetera. So in those particular orgs, it's very clear, like, what your path to success or management or anything like that will be. However, if you're in an organization that is less mature, oftentimes it's very unclear what it would look like to be a successful product manager. And so like, for instance, I've been in companies where as I'm kind of, figuring out what we need to build as a product, I'm also figuring out exactly what my career structure should be. And then it's also usually one of the smallest teams in the company. So for instance, my largest project org that I've ever been in, right? And I'm trying to think, so in a company of, let's say 100,000 people, there were still less than 150 product managers, right? And so when you start thinking about that, in terms of other teams, like, engineering might have, 10x or 20x, designers might even have 5 or 10x the number of product managers. And so for that reason, you're often doing a lot of work, that would be spread across potentially multiple verticals and multiple people in a more traditional, like larger product organization. And so it does become like very difficult to kind of figure out, okay, how am I going to, create the greatest impact with the least amount of resources. So that's something that I always want to remind people of, is that it is kind of like, it's kind of difficult to kind of work with such a small part of the business. But it can be thankless work. So one of the things I mentioned is that one of my previous roles was, customer support, right? And so, I always, joke that like the two most thankless jobs in a company is often customer service and product management, right? Because the product management, because you have so much responsibility and you are paid well, people forget that you also still want like all of the nice amenities, like a nice work-life balance and all these other things that everyone else at the company might have. And the same thing for customer service. I remember when I was in customer service, the whole company would stop at 5 o'clock, but if there were any calls or any tickets left, we also had to keep working on Friday or something like that. And so I think it's like very similar. So you do have to figure out what makes the most sense for you. And lastly, burnout is a real thing. So out of all the types of jobs I've had, like one of the things I've noticed is that product managers, if you don't kind of go through and think about these like other four bullet points that I put here, is that you will burn out because it is so much work. It's a lot of responsibility. And so you have to be very precise in your boundaries. You have to be very precise in trying to figure out what to do so that you can kind of retain the capacity to continue to love it every single solitary day. But you know, when it all comes down to it, I do this though because like I really, really, really like making stuff for people, right? You know, so this is one of my very favorite quotes, right? Like, I don't know, like there's almost nothing like the feeling of building something, having it go well, and then seeing, you know, on Twitter or on Facebook or wherever, someone saying, this was a really great product. Like, this is such a great thing. I would love to thank the team that did this. Like, that's one of the coolest parts of the job. And it's something that, like, there's not many ways, I think, in the world to work at a company that you get that type of recognition just out in the world. And there's something that's, like, super powerful and super amazing about that. And so that's something that I always kind of retain, is just that desire to just make something great that makes people's lives really, really easy. Now, I said, you know, again, this is pretty short because I think the majority of what we should do is actually talk, right? So let's get to the question section.
Well, so far there are no questions in the chat, but do folks have questions?
I have a question.
Go for it.
So, hi, B, by the way. So, B, actually, I've reached out to B in the past, and she's helped me to navigate some things. So, nice to see your face.
Yeah.
I guess I could come on camera, too. Sorry. So, I interviewed for a role that was product manager. Got to my interview, and then they were like, oh, we had a reorg. So the title's not product management, but you'll essentially be doing the same thing. So I have skills that would easily transition into being a product manager within my company. But I also know that there's hardly any Black product managers at the company that I work at. So I'm just curious to know like your tips in transitioning and navigating in that space.
Yeah, so there's a couple different things here. So first and foremost, the bait and switch is totally a thing, right? So like that actually has happened. And in fact, reorgs especially. So that goes to the idea of like the fact that the product organizations at various companies, many of them are not mature. And so like they're always reorging, right? They're always trying to figure out exactly how they're gonna do alignment. So there's the first thing I would actually say is that you could in theory stay and try to become a product manager at that organization. But it also is kind of a red flag that they're telling you that it's like you're going to be doing product management like things, right? Because if you are doing product management like things, then you should have that title. So I just want to be clear that like from the first blush of it, you know, that might not be the best value add for you long term because they have that mentality. But let's assume you are going to stay at that company. So then I would say that there's a couple of different things. The simple fact is that there are not that many Black product managers at my company, right? There's not that many Black product managers at any company that I've actually, you know, participated or known about thus far in my career. And so the thing is that you're going to have to find a teacher or an ally who is not a Black person, right? And so, and the one way to do that is, you know, I love just having one-on-ones with people, right? So like, so one of my value, like one of my core values is that if I want something is that I'm just going to go start talking to people and become friends with people and then have them love me a little bit so that when I actually need that opportunity, I can come back to them and say, hey, you know, you love me. Like, can you go ahead and help me get that job? Right? Because this is the way that you kind of go about it. So again, if you're going to stay at that company, you're going to have to start, you know, and again, you can start from the lowest, you know, denominator. Like it doesn't even have to be like a director. Like you can just start from like any person who has a product management title. So, you know, I would love to have coffee with you because you have this title and I'm trying to figure out like what types of things do I need to improve on or what do you think from the perspective of my current role that I could kind of apply so I could potentially get that title.
Yeah, I know that's great advice. And I've started doing that aspect of networking, just trying to figure that out. I don't necessarily feel like it was a bait and switch specific to me, just to give clarity. They actually changed the title of my teammates before I even came on board because their definition of a product manager is someone who has a dedicated dev team. And they moved our dev team to the larger part of the brand. So now we have to interact with other product managers. So we still, for our partner, we still manage like their feature enhancements and backlog and things like that, but we just don't have a dedicated dev team. So they, by their definition, had to change the title, but the duties that we do are still similar, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and by the way, I wasn't saying it was a bait switch just to you. I'm just saying that sometimes, you know, it, they should have thought about what that would look like, right?
Yeah.
And then secondly, that notion of having a dedicated dev team is very antiquated. A lot of modern product companies, like, they don't have dedicated dev teams. In fact, you know, a lot of the product managers who work at Netflix, they actually just get to raise their hand and say, you know, we've approved this particular strategy, we need these types of resources, and then we all just kind of lean in. Like, so for instance, the developers who I typically work with will be tapped on the shoulder, and then they'll go help work on that thing. But again, you know, that's it goes to that idea of like different companies are at different points in terms of like their evolution in terms of how to build successful technology as well.
Fantastic. And then Oletta Reed asked a question. Oletta, would you like to ask me your question?
Sure. Here's my face. Hi. So one of the things that I hooked into at the beginning of your presentation was leading with authority. And I wanted to know from a project management perspective, what does that look like? And just for a little background, I come from advertising and marketing background, and I know what it looks like in my industry as far as leadership, but would be really interested to know in how you go about, or an example of where you've owned a room and owned your strategy going into a meeting with a diverse group of people.
So I think there's a couple different examples here. So first and foremost, like one of the weird thing about my career. So at one point I went to law school, although I did not quit. I quit because I was like, wait, this is real expensive. And I don't think I'm going to get paid more than I would get paid doing this other thing. But one of the things that's happened in my career is that I'm often like, when I go into spaces, technology companies, especially, I have this like sixth sense for like compliance issues. And so like when I go into those spaces, like I make it a big deal to like make sure I understand what that looks like. And so there's a recent issue that came up and I realized that we might not be in compliance. And so when I brought it up, a bunch of people were just like, oh, well, that's not that big a deal. Like, it'll be fine, like whatever. And so what I actually did is I wrote up a whole memo and I was just like, okay, so this is exactly what the issue is. This is why this is an issue. This is how much it's going to cost us. And these are examples of other companies who weren't in compliance and what that actually looked like, right? And so what you have here is that I created a very succinct recap of the issue, gave them the actual value, and then put in the actual, you know, penalty that would occur. And so then I got to, you know, present that to VPs, you know, senior leaders or like whatever. And they were just like, why do you care about this thing? And I was just like, you know, I am your product manager at your company. And it's my responsibility to make sure that you're getting the business value that you deserve. And so that means that I need to be looking at all aspects of any area that I'm responsible for to make sure I can do that. And so that's part of that leading with authority. Like, I specifically think I own a part of my company, right? There's no question in my mind that this company is just as much mine as it is anyone else's. And so that means that every single aspect of this company is partially my responsibility. And so going to like, so that's part of it. It's like, so you have to imbue yourself with like that energy about your company, especially as a product manager, because again, you have that outsized influence and the ability to affect so much tremendous change with your company. So you have to start with that. And so if people don't believe that part of it, you're not even going to get to any ability to lead anything else, right? So then separately, talking about rooms. So y'all can't tell, but like, I'm 5'2", like I'm real small. Like, I'm like this small human, right? So like, I'm never going to take up so much space in a room that like, they're going to stop what they're doing to be like, bees in the room, right? So like, this is what, so one of the things that I do, and that goes back to like my strategy about one-on-ones and things like that, is that I make sure that I meet with various stakeholders on a regular basis to just remind them of who I am, right? Remind them of my value, of my knowledge, of my skill set, of why they should care about what I say when I'm in a room. So then when I actually get into those rooms, everyone is already kind of like, oh, it's bees day. I already know that I'm going to get taught something. We're going to do some stuff. I'm going to get asked to do some other stuff, and it's going to work out. So the thing about leading with authority is that it's not just about the room. It's all about all that pre-work that you have to do. So whether that's about, you know, making those specific connections so that you can kind of proceed from there, whether it's documenting things or doing the research to make sure that you have all of your, you know, I's dotted, your T's crossed, like you have to do all of those things so that when you actually get into those spaces, like your authority is already there. And then you just get to be that person that people defer to.
Thank you.
Awesome. Are there any other questions?
Hi, this is Tracy. Hi. I just want to say hi. Thank you for that great presentation, B. Thank you, Lexi, for acknowledging the fact that I was the one who brought you two together. I just want to say to you, B, you know my story. I came out to the West Coast trying to get into that whole field, but because I never had the title, I've done many jobs, but I was told, nah, they're not going to hire you because you have not had the title of product manager or product marketing manager. And your journey that you share with us is very different, but I agree. I guess sometimes if we do want to transition into that role, that title, you just have to know the right person to give you a break. Am I right?
Well, it's a little bit of that, but you know, again, like I said, the way I actually got into product management is because I was a subject matter expert at the thing that I was trying to get into. And obviously I do know a lot about your background. So, you know, there is that ability to potentially, you know, work at another role. So for instance, one of the people I mentored recently, her strategy was actually getting into a role within the company. And she did do that strategy of like knowing people. And I'm gonna be truthful. When she got the role at the company, she was like, girl, you know, I don't want this role. This is not what I want to do. Like, this is not what I want to do for the rest of my life. And I was like, I agree. I don't want you to do that for the rest of your life either. Right. Mm-hmm. And so she's basically spent 6 dedicated months. Like, so she did 6 months of like work, and then she knew she could switch at a year. So then she did 6 months of like talking to every product person, understanding every single area of the business. And then one of the product managers who was hiring for a role liked her so much that they hired her for the product management role, right? So I do think that it is a little bit of knowing people, but I'm gonna be truthful. It's also about like, it's so much about being an expert at something, right? That's the number one thing. In fact, I was reading for someone I really respect today, and she was talking about her first product management role. And it turns out she actually got the product management role because she was writing a lot of articles and blogs just in general about that particular area. And so the person who was actually looking for someone to be a product manager in that area of the business happened to see one of her blogs and was so impressed and called her in for the interview, right? And also even for my purposes, so my job at Netflix, my manager, he was doing Google searches for people who are product managers in the area or who had product management experience. And he actually found me, through internet search. And he was just like, once I actually did the internet search and then found you, I realized that you had exactly the type of experience that I was looking for. Cause he's like, first I was looking for product managers, but then you actually have specific experience with, you know, finance data and all these other things. So I do think that there's a combination of knowing people is always the easiest way, right? So obviously that's simply the easiest way, but then it's being an expert, and then it's also promotion, right? And that's the thing that we as Black folks in general don't do well. Like, in fact, one of my coworkers, this dude, he's like one of the smartest dudes. Like, I mean, just honestly, he's so smooth. Like, he's like Eddie Murphy from Boomerang smooth. Like, that's how smooth this dude is, right? And he got this amazing promotion, and he didn't say anything. And so I was the one who announced to like the whole Black Ed group and everyone we knew that he got this job. And he was just like, well, I just didn't want people to think that I was just like feeling myself too much or whatever. And so there's a part of that, right? Like, we do need to promote ourselves better. Like, for instance, I always tell people when I was in Chicago, I felt like I didn't really get any of the recognition that I should have gotten as a product manager. And I'm just like, why didn't I get that? And as soon as I put myself out there to write stuff and to be a speaker and to be on panels, all of a sudden, I started getting all the attention. And in fact, you know, my job at Apple, I got because I was at a speaking engagement in San Francisco. And the woman was like, I was so impressed with how you talked about the, you know, agile methodologies and all these different things. At Apple, we really want to, you know, be more agile. And I just really think that you could be great here. Would you be okay if I introduced you to some of the hiring managers? And I was like, girl, sure. I'm not going to complain about getting introduced. So I think there's complexity. There's definitely layers to this, right? And obviously, we know the game is stacked against us. In fact, you know, you can read half the things Lexi posts and she will tell you the game is stacked against us. So we do have to, you know, we have to have layers upon layers upon layers of ways that we kind of engage to kind of make sure that we kind of, you know, hit every single level so that we'll get the same opportunities. Now, what I was saying is that now that I've had, you know, the jobs, it's really easy now, right? But I had to go through that process and gamemanship to a certain extent to get to that point where I could have that opportunity.
Okay. Well, thank you. I won't give up hope then, but I'm back here on the East Coast. I don't think I'm coming back out here, but thank you.
To be truthful, the West Coast is on fire half the time. So, I mean, I'm just saying. I got you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much, B.
And B, I think you actually brought up a good point. And maybe, Issa, we should make this a masterclass at some point about this idea of personal branding, because I think that it comes up a lot, but I always tell Black women, personal branding is not an option for us. It is a requirement. You do not know the opportunities that I've received, the interviews that I've received just by standing on a stage and speaking about trees. Like, people are just like, oh, that was great. We should talk about this job, right? And so, Issa, we should make note of that. And I think we need to have a conversation. B is 100% correct. I cannot express that personal branding is a requirement for Black people. I do not care what white people tell you. It is an option for them. It is a requirement for us in order to have a stable career.
Thank you, Lexi. Okay.
Linda, I think, Linda, did you want to add something or say something?
Yes, I do. Thank you. So, B, I'm actually a product owner. And one thing that we're going through right now at our organization is that we just merged with another organization and there's a lot of change going on. So we're getting a lot of new leadership in. And the organization I'm with, they've been doing things kind of archaically for the last 7 years. So these new leaders are coming in and they're talking Scrum and they're talking SAFe and all those wonderful things. Earlier you mentioned something about if there's training or certification, and this is the question I have for you, so I can make myself marketable to these new leaders. There is actually a certified Scrum product owner course or certification. Do you think that would even be worthwhile to maybe enhance myself to these new leaders?
So first and foremost, I have one of those. So that it's one of the certifications I actually 100% approve of, especially if you go through, there's like a whole website that you can go through and there's different trainers. And so you can actually go and like review each of those different like trainers, right? Then you can figure out, like, for instance, this trainer has a better reputation than this one over here. So I do think there's a difference in who you get it from, because a lot of people, especially because it became a big deal to do the CSM, which is the Certified Scrum Master and Certified Scrum Project Owner. So a lot of people popped up and did set up these training schools, but they're not all the same, honestly. There's also another certification called the PMI ACP, which is basically the project. So it's the PMP for Agile professionals, or the way I think about it is that it's the PMP for technology related teams, right? And so those are the things that you have to think about. And yeah, the question was the certification free? The certifications are not free, but there's a big difference in price. So again, like for instance, one program that I went through was like $300, but I could have gone through the program that was like $2,000 or $3,000, right? So there's a huge, huge difference in terms of pricing and things like that. And that's something to keep in mind. One thing I wanted, because I'm a product person, so I have to ask this question. I have to probe for a little bit more context. So when you said that, like, what systems were your team working using before Scrum and SAFe?
Well, this is interesting too. There's a small digital team. They have always been operating in an agile manner. But then over here, this is so interesting about IT and the different silos. Over here, in this other part of IT, they were very more waterfall, not willing to be quick to develop. I'm just very cautious, overly cautious, not willing to take risks. So it's that team over here that was in this other organization now that wants to jump in over here with this new and upcoming silo because they're doing exciting things and they're delivering and you see it on a continuous basis. So.
Okay. So first and foremost, on my website, so it's bpagelsminor.com, I did this presentation a couple of years ago at a conference. It's like how to choose the right type of agile methodology for your team, right? I would suggest checking that out because the thing is that what people don't understand is not every team in a company has to follow the same type of methodology, right? So that's one thing I want you to keep in mind is that while it might make you more marketable, one thing that you should also do as a product owner or product manager is challenge whether things like what changes actually need to happen and why, right? Because like if you have a product, for instance, that is super, that has to be in compliance, right? Like, so for instance, medical products, you know, have to be HIPAA compliance, you know, insurance products have to have their certain compliance. Agile might not actually be the best tool for you. It actually might be better to do waterfall because you're going to make sure, because you're doing all that pre-work beforehand to make sure everything is everything is worked through. You're going to have legal, you're going to have your control, like all those people go through it. Waterfall makes more sense. If you really can just like go out there and develop whatever you want, then agile, and there's lots of different agile, right? Because there's Scrum, there's Lean, there's Kanban. You can use the Spotify squat model where everyone has a different, you know, type of agile. So there's a lot of different options. So to your original question, are certifications worth it? Those certifications are ones that I don't mind, right? Like those are ones that I definitely, my CSPO class specifically was foundationally one of the best classes I've ever taken, right? Because the guy who taught the class, he'd been doing agile transformations at companies for like 30, 40 years or something like that. And so he just had so much like specific information about the difficulties that you might face as a product manager that it just was really great for me. And every single day I refer to some tip that he provided in terms of like conflict management and things like that. So to your original point, yes, I think those certifications can be very useful. And to Lexi's point, you should try to get your company to pay for it if possible. My company has actually paid for my certifications, which is one of the reasons I got them all really quickly. And then after you get your certifications, you just have to do like the certain number of classes. So for instance, I even get credit for this, for teaching y'all some stuff. Like I get an hour of certification, so I get to keep my certifications for 3 more years. So there's some really good stuff out there.
Yeah. Well, thank you, B. I appreciate that. I have a question for Alexandria real quick. Alexandria, you had mentioned about basically marketing or sales, or what was the term you used? Was it marketing? Mm-hmm. Yeah, your branding. So what examples do you have of how you personally branded yourself?
Well, this masterclass is about bees. So let me tell you examples from bees. So bee and I became really cool from a personality level, but I knew very quickly bee was good at what bee does. Like I said, we had lunch and we were just talking about life. The next day I was at a conference and we were the only 2 black humans at the conference. And then also laughing at the fact that we just met having lunch, but it was very clear at the conference when questions were being asked about product and that kind of thing, that B knew exactly what they were talking about. And B, correct me if I'm wrong, but fast forward, the conference producers asked B to speak at another conference. So literally, B was at a conference and we were having Q&A and talking about stuff. And B was being B, talking about some product stuff, I forgot the topic, which led to the conference producers in the corner to say, we should invite this human to this thing we're doing about product. And that was a speaking engagement, right? For B. Fast forward, we spoke at Lesbians Who Tech, not together, but we spoke separately. But if you've ever been to Lesbians Who Tech, because it's a huge conference, they put the speakers in like blocks. So it's like 5 speakers, 20 minutes each, right? And then a break, and then 5 speakers, 20 minutes each. And so B and I spoke, I think, in the same 5 to 10 cohort. And it was very clear in that moment when B spoke that they knew exactly what they were talking about, to the point that when they got off stage, everyone was rushing over. And some of those people, I'm sure, because Lesbians Who Tech is one of the largest tech conferences out there, were students, people trying to get jobs, but there were also news reporters, there were also recruiters from other companies saying like, hey, we should definitely talk. And so again, Issa and I have to figure out how we can do this masterclass. Maybe I'll do it. We'll find somebody else to do it. But I think it's just really important that you are always showing people exactly who you are, right? And so a good example is that when somebody asks you, how are you, right? Instead of saying, oh, I'm doing good, it's great to say, I'm doing great. And you know why? Because today at work, I help finalize ABC. And that is not, that's not bragging. That is not this idea that you think you're better than everyone else. But personal branding just comes to the fact that if people don't know what you do and that you're good at it, they're not going to contact you. And that's what B has done in their career. One of the ways that B has done that is through speaking engagements. I think speaking engagements is one of the easiest ways because you'll be on a stage in front of, you know, 100 to up to, you know, 50,000 people. So it's just, you have this large audience and you're saying, this is what I do. So that's how many, you know, whatever number of people in the audience now knows that like Linda does ABC, right? Sometimes the quickest way. But I think sometimes people forget that those are the times for people to know what you do. And then even put it on a micro level, when you're in a room at work and you're in a 20 person conference room and someone has a question, but you have the answer. You don't know how many times I have seen people, especially people of color, just sit there and I know they know the answer and they won't say anything. That's your speaking opportunity, because now the other 19 people in this room know exactly who you are and know that you know what you're talking about. Right. So those are just some high points, but I agree with you. I do think that we need to have a very deep dive on that because I just do think it's a requirement for Black women.
I want to riff on that a little bit too, I think. So one of the things I did a few years ago when I was really trying to figure out how to be successful is I took a step back and said, what the heck do I actually want to do? Right. And so for me, obviously, I want to economically make money because money is the way that you can kind of do what the hell you want to do, right? So that's like, that was the first step for me. But it's like, how do you go about doing that? And so for me personally, that was about, okay, I want to be authentic in every room. You know, I know I'm naturally a storyteller. Like, I like being able to do work as a product manager that allows me to tell great stories with my products, right? So like, when you actually start kind of breaking down who you are, then you have to actually live up to that. And actually, I was listening to Dr. Tracy Cotton. She was having a talk with Nikki Giovanni. And people were asking her a very similar question to what you asked us. And they were like, well, how do you go about doing this and figuring out if you're going to be successful or whatever? And she's like, honestly, the number one thing I do and how I decide to live my life is that I wonder, is this going to be embarrassing later, right? And so what she meant by that is that she's just like, I have a platform. And so the thing is, every single person on this call has a platform. You have a group of people who respect you, who care about you, right? And so if you think about that, like if you were to go out into the world and you aren't authentic to who you are, if you aren't thinking about like your strategies to be successful, if you aren't thinking about how you're gonna feed your family, right? Like you could stumble and embarrass yourself, right? And be, and create an issue or create a world where you're gonna be less successful. And then she also, the other thing I love about that, so one of the things that's kind of difficult, so for instance, my wife recently was like, so don't you want to be an influencer? And I was like, absolutely not. Like, I literally am not trying to be an influencer at all. Like, it's actually terrifying to me, influencer culture, right? Because like, all of a sudden you have to be a pundit. Like, so every time something happens, you have to have an opinion about it. But I don't. I have opinions about product management. I have opinions about being Southern. I have opinions about being a part of the extended Black women group. Like, those are things that I want to talk about. And so I stick to the things that are core to me. I don't try to expand and go outside of that and do other things because it's inauthentic and it comes across that way. And so that means that when I go out into the world, if I try to represent myself in those ways, people aren't going to, it's not going to speak to people, which means that it's going to kind of, it's going to encumber me from doing what I want to do. Right. And so Tanisha, Tanisha, so you talked about the certificate programs. So there's like a couple of major lists. Like Scrum Alliance is a great place to go to. So Scrum Alliance will actually have every single practitioner in your area. And so once you see who the practitioners are, you can then do the searches on like Yelp and things like that. So for instance, this is one of the great things about so many of the review aggregators is that you can actually then go out and see on those review aggregators, you know, what people are saying about them. And it's actually really funny because like I saw some comments being like, this was some BS. I mean, I got my certificate, that's fine. But like, I don't think I learned anything. Whereas other ones were like, you know, this person was foundational. They gave me so much great information. And in fact, I've contacted them 2 or 3 times since then. And like, they've been able to help me navigate situations. So that's the type of thing that you're kind of looking for when I'm talking about those like review programs.
Thank you.
And then we have a question. Oh, go ahead. Who was talking? Go ahead.
Oh, no, that was Issa just jumping in to just point the mic at Tylisa in the chat has a question. I think I'm saying your name. Forgive me if I'm saying your name wrong.
Yes, that's correct. So B, I just wanted to say, you did a pretty good job of leveraging your employee resource groups within the companies that you work for. Can you talk a little bit about how you went about participating in employee resource groups and how it translated into being more productive in your day job?
So, I mean, I know half the people out there are like, how does Tylisa know this? Well, Tylisa and I work together at Apple. So one of the things that, so going to this point of many of us are going to be one or one of the few of us who look like us in companies, right? And so one of the things you have to think about is like, how do you go about having a community, right? Because community is a super important thing to be successful anywhere, like, you know, personal or professional. And so to Tylisa's point, so for instance, I was a part of Black at Apple. At Netflix, I'm part of Black at Netflix and also the Transstar and the Pride groups and all those different types of things. So there's a couple different things. First and foremost, being a part of those groups is usually the best way to get context across what's going on in all the companies. So again, if you want to be a product manager, you have to be someone who really understands business value. Like, how am I going to create business value for people? Well, the number one way to create business value is to understand what the heck the business is doing, right? And so you, as one person, it's often difficult to necessarily go in and specifically figure out the whole hierarchy and all those different types of things. And so that's why it's great to have an employee research group, because generally speaking, there's going to be people who've been there way longer than you. And so you can ask them for questions and kind of figure out, okay, so what has happened? What do you think has, you know, what do you think is the future type of state? And so because of that, that gave me like this really great ability to, going back to the point before about leading with authority. So leading with facts is usually the one of the best ways to lead with authority. And so if you have all of that context and all that information, it allows you to be even better at what your role is and what your job can be, so you can kind of move forward. Secondly, employee resource groups, if any of those people are hiring, they usually will pass on the hiring, what the roles are being hired for before anyone else. In fact, you know, like at Netflix, the Black at Netflix, there are 2 or 3 roles that open up that I happen to know, you know, perfect people for. And so I was able to just, you know, quickly, you know, pass those resumes over to those people, which means I'm going to get those opportunities. But on the flip side of it, if I was looking for an opportunity, I would also know about those opportunities beforehand. And then to that point, so a lot of that sounds like, oh, I've used those organizations without actually giving back. So the other part of it is that you also have to figure out how you can provide value, right? So when you are in these resource groups, it's not just about taking and getting those resources. It's also about figuring out how you can provide value to people, right? So, you know, for me, like, for instance, there were like some Slack channels that I created for like specific bespoke things. I made sure that those kind of communities existed. I also participated in various events. And so it's also about like that kind of give and take, because you want to make sure that like you have a really great, again, going back to the idea of brand, you want to make sure you have a really great brand within those employee resource groups as well.
I have a question, if we still have time here.
Well, actually, it looks like we have one from Jolie and then also one from S. Cooper, and then we'll come back to you, Daniela. I just want to make sure that we go in order because, again, as a product manager, this is who I am.
Awesome. Thank you.
Hi, B. I had a quick question regarding what we were discussing prior when it came to CSPO. You mentioned something that was really important in your experience, which was you learned conflict resolution during your time, you know, acquiring that CSPO certification. So I really want to know how to deal with, and this question comes up often in PM interviews, so, especially relating to collaborating with the engineering team. So if you haven't had too much exposure in that field or in that environment, and you're asked that question, what's a good way to kind of showcase your leadership or teamwork ability you know, to encompass what, like, you know, the skills that you already have.
So, Joey, do you have any siblings?
Yeah.
Okay. So if your sibling wanted the last of the orange juice, how did you navigate that?
I didn't get any.
Yeah. So that's the whole point. Like, so the thing is that we have a lot of life experiences, right, that are actual real things, especially when you first, like, when you first are getting into any type of career path and things like that, there has to be something that is similar. So for instance, taking my experience of being a store manager at Target, so like, because that would have been my preceding experience before I got into my first tech job. If someone had asked me, how do I do leadership or things like that, I would have said, you know, one of the best things I've learned at Target is that there are 300 team members, you know, just for my section of Target. I didn't need to rethink how to be a cashier. I didn't need to rethink how to merchandise our aisles. All I had to do was empower those folks to be the best version of themselves and say, even though I'm the manager, y'all are smarter than me. What do you think we should do? Right. And so I displayed this idea of partnership and collaboration. You know, and so even though I had never been a PM before, I'd had multiple experiences of like what it looks like to be a great leader and be a great team member. I also played softball. You know, I would tell people, you know, like in softball, there's come the time where you might have to bunt. Even though you're a power hitter, you're going to bunt because that's going to score the run. And that's what's most important. Right. So I think that the one thing, and in fact, I was coaching my sister because she has an interview next week. One thing we have to remember is you have to write down what you've done, right? Because when we think about our lives, sometimes we diminish our accomplishments. But the simple fact is, if you are a Black woman in America and you're alive, right, you've done some pretty damn things, pretty damn good things, you know what I'm saying? So yeah. Start taking down, writing down what you've done, writing down why that matters, and then translate that into what you would say in an interview, right? Okay. And I think that's really great.
Awesome. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So next we have S. Cooper.
Hello, hi, how are you? Hi, so I have a question. I'm sorry if you covered this already. I know you mentioned in the beginning of the PowerPoint how there's some people who may go through a vocational program or, you know, grad school or all of that. So my question is, how was your experience? Like, did you learn on the job or did you take any courses in PM? Like, how did you learn about how to be a product manager?
Yeah, so first of all, whatever you're cooking, I hope that's really delicious because, like, I'm real hungry right now. So you got me up here fiending a little bit. But then separately, so first of all, I'm a part of like what I consider to be an older generation of product managers. So there was a lot less formal training when I first started. So for instance, product school and almost every certificate program that exists now did not exist when I started. And so my first product management jobs was really learning on the job. And then also everyone I reported to had also learned on the job. So I will say that mine was learning on the job. And then I didn't get my first certificates until 4 years ago, 3 years ago, something like that. So I started, my first product manager job was 2012. But I didn't get my first certificate until 2017, right? So I think that's some interesting context there. However, on the flip side of that, in modern product management, chances are you would probably get some kind of certificate or some kind of, there's an opportunity to get some kind of certificate that you could then translate into being able to get into product management. So it's a little bit different. However, I would also suggest I mentioned a lot of the opportunities or the perfect scenarios that I mentioned were at large technology companies. If you're looking to first get in product management, I highly encourage people to look at startups because they're much more likely to, you know, hire people who have that non-traditional product management path. And I think that's a really great and important way to get into product management because, again, product management, there is, that's what I'm looking for. There's no perfect path to product management, in my opinion, even with the people who have followed these steps. I still think it's all about those kind of unknown skills, that the class type of things more so than about that formality of teaching. Because I've known so many people who are Harvard MBAs, who have every certificate known to mankind, and they suck at product management. Legitimately some of the worst product managers I've ever worked with because they never worked on those other skills. And that those other skills are what I think are most important.
Thank you. Thank you.
So Daniela, you're up.
Hi, thank you. All right, so I really liked your presentation. First, I want to say that. I see myself in this path that is opening up positions in my job to be product operations manager, which my understanding is a little bit different than product management. So I guess the first thing is asking what you see the differences are. And just to give some information about my background is I have been tech support, customer support, training support. I've done everything that is a role in customer experience I have done. And honestly, for the last 4 or 5 years that I have been having a seat at the table for any time that there is discussion with product, with designers, with engineers of how to improve product. And I've actually been training some of the people that have been given this role of product operations for the last 2-3 cycles of people at my job. So I feel like this job that is opening up is mine, but I just want to see from your perspective, and also looking at the salary scales that you showed, business analysts, does that sound similar to product operations, or what is your take on that?
Yeah, so first of all, I want to start with a slightly aside point, but also then come back to your point. So when I think about my career now, I no longer think I'm going to be a chief product officer. For instance, I don't think that would be my goal if I were to have my terminal title. It would actually be chief operations officer. And one of the reasons for that is because I'm finding as I kind of grow in my career, product at some point goes from, okay, I'm going to work on this particular point of the business to how can I change the entire company to have the right mentality and ideas so that the entire company as a product is great, right? And so it's I want to be the product manager of companies. And so I say that because there's some interesting thing about this product operations manager role, right? So first and foremost, most times that I've seen a product operations management role, it's generally a role where, so product managers, again, we deliver the business value, but not every product manager is good about knowing every tool that's out there, optimizing those tools and all those different types of things. So for instance, let's say if you have a team of analysts, a lot of times the product operations manager actually might be the person who manages that team. And so that team, they're basically working directly with the product managers to kind of amplify what the product managers are doing, because the product managers maybe don't have the capacity to also kind of maintain all of the machinery around all of the testing suites and all those other types of things. So I do think there's a lot of value in this role, especially because it's one that could work in any company, right? Because there's all of those things that are going around product management all the time. That's really great. But having said that, it is going to be slightly different, right? So I would actually look at operations roles, salaries, to get a sense of what the actual salary should be for this one versus a product manager. But because it is operations for product management, I would still suspect that it should be pretty high up there, or at least it was in some of the companies I've been at. But again, I don't know that much about your particular company, so I don't want to, lead you to believe that if it's not true. But in terms of viability, I think it's great. In fact, one of the things that, as my career has gone by, I don't necessarily even like to build products necessarily for users, a typical user anymore. I get a lot of joy out of building really great tools for my internal teams, because again, it supercharges their ability to be successful, which means that my stock goes up, right? Because I'm selfish like that. I'm like, we need to all make money, but especially me. So I could do something else if I really wanted to. I hope I answered your question. Like I said, it's a little complex because it's not as straight as an answer as some of the other ones are, but I do think there's a lot of value in that role.
Thank you.
Awesome. We have time for one more question this evening. If anybody's got a good juicy one. Okay. Well,
I'm sorry, but I was just thinking, because you work at Netflix, and Netflix is just showing up, blowing up, especially with all the content that we can, Eva, that's so strange, they can't see me. Okay. She took her hair down. She is relaxed.
I like it. I love it so much. Take this
part down. Okay, I'll take that part down. But I'm just curious to know, like, what has that been like? I know that Netflix has changed leadership. I'm just curious to know, just like from an inside view, what it's been like being a product manager there. And what's been in your other roles.
So first and foremost, there's this Netflix culture doc, which I actually encourage everyone to read because it is actually my personal values. So we're talking, again, this personal branding thing comes back over and over again. And when you do have your, if you understand your values, when you read this culture doc, I read this and I was like, every single thing here is actually what I personally believe, right? Like, I personally believe everything here. And what's cool about it is that actually is how Netflix operates. Like, Netflix, everything that's in that document, they expect you to kind of go forward and do what's right. So there's like two key points that I really like. One is the freedom and responsibility. So like you have the freedom and responsibility to do whatever you think is best for Netflix. And there's also using good judgment. So those are two key points that I really love. And I'm gonna be truthful, most of the companies I've worked at, they don't have those values, right? Like there's a very short leash. You can't really go outside of those boundaries. And the thing is as again, I told you like, you know, as my career has grown, I started thinking, well, I don't necessarily need to worry about the product. I need to make sure the company is good. Because if we can make the company good, everything else will work itself out. And so because of that, like idea of freedom, responsibility, and good judgment, it means that if I see something that's wrong, I can actually just go raise my hand and tell my manager, by the way, I think I need to go focus over here because like, I think this is more important. And in fact, going back to that question about employee resource groups. So I've been very fortunate to, you know, kind of come in at the Black Hat and the Trans Star groups and have some influence. And I think I might, you know, put myself up for a leadership role. And so I told my manager that, and he was just like, okay, cool. So we may have to pivot how we're like, what percentage of your work will be X versus what percentage of your work will be this ERG. And he was like, because you know his personal philosophy and Netflix's personal philosophy is that these ERG groups are helping us create that amazing content, right? You know, one of the things Ava DuVernay said about us was that, you know, Netflix is the number one provider of Black images in the world, right? And so, but the reason for that is that our Black Ed group is so powerful and so influential in all of Netflix. And so we are able to influence every aspect of the business. And, you know, for me as a Black trans person, I also want to see Black trans faces and things like that. And so my manager's like, and he's like, oh yeah, I totally, he's like, when I hired you, I should have known that was going to be something that you're going to focus on. And so for instance, we've allocated up to 30% of my time helping with those two particular ERGs, as well as recruiting in general for Netflix, right? And so that's the thing that's really powerful, is that for the first time in my life that I can come fully to work with like my sass, my loudness, my everything, and then be rewarded for that and be told that that's the most valuable thing that I can provide. So that's something that's really, really amazing. And also to be truthful, the stories they say about Netflix, about it being some of the stunning, most talented people in the world, like legitimately it is. Like it legitimately, like the level of intelligence and thoughtfulness and empathy, and it's really, really wonderful being at a place with so many talented individuals.
Thanks for sharing. To that point, thank you so much. And you know, Sista Circle really started as an idea of having an ERG that didn't have a company that it was based in, right? So we, Lexi and I, really try to model the work that we do here as that kind of idea, and that our community is this larger community of Black folks. So I really appreciate you hitting onto the point of that. And thank you so much, Bea. This was a really awesome presentation, and you clearly know a lot about what it is that you do and speak with quite a bit of confidence. And I feel like folks definitely got a lot out of this. I also just want to commend you and just want to acknowledge that today with current court rulings and the Breonna Taylor verdict, that I know that we all struggled today to show up. So I just want to thank you, Bea, for showing up and bringing your best self to this space and your full self to this space and sharing your knowledge, because I know it was really hard for all of us to show up today. So thank you very much for that. We really appreciate you. And to all the other sisters in the room, thank you so much for being here with us. You know, we're going to keep trying to create this content and share this knowledge. And And, you know, think of what, to B's point about getting to know folks and knowing folks in different places and how that influences and stuff. Think of Sista Circle as another place for doing that, and feel free to reach out, continue to reach out to each other. And last question from Jolie, just because I had to throw it in there. Is that shirt from Beychella?
Of course.
Okay.
No, it's actually funny, like with everything that's been going on, like the amount of Black like creator stuff that I've bought is like ridiculous. But yeah, I like every day it's like super Black. Like it's like
all day, all the time. You know, so thank you. And also to the point of the how Netflix reacts, I think that you know, watch how your company reacts right now. And that will give you a lot of information about your own personal experience. How they react to everything else globally will give you a lot. So I commend Netflix, and I'm glad that they're taking my money and my streams right now. Makes me feel better. So to that point, I appreciate all of you. I don't know if Lexi has any parting words. I know that she got called into the Twitterverse, so she may have had to have jumped off for an emergency. Are you here?
Haven't jumped off yet, but I need to go work on the Twitterverse. But yes, stay Black, stay bold, stay Black.
All right. Good evening.
Good night, ladies. Be safe.
You too. Bye-bye.